Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum. My name is Ghulam Muhyiddin. I am from MBA ITM 20 from the Faculty of Management Sciences. Today, the topic which I am going to present here is value-added services. And the contents which I will cover in this presentation are, first of all, the introduction about the value-added services, then service industry's characteristics. After that, the internet commercialization of internet service providers, then logistics of being an internet service, then we will discuss value-added networks. After that, we will discuss internal control in third-party networks. Then we will discuss the liability of third-party network vendors. And finally, we will discuss about the conclusion of this presentation. Now, let's first of all talk about the introduction. In the beginning, let's have some introduction about service sector. Service sector does not mean polishing shoes or making chips from potatoes. Service sector nowadays is providing a great support to all manufacturing sector also. Some myths related to the value-added services are leading some decision makers or policy makers to not use their full potential. Nowadays, managers who are taking support from these value-added services are making decisions in more accurate way. In future, the manufacturing sector will also try to be more service-oriented. As you can see, nowadays, computer-aided services like as AutoCAD and Autodesk products from these companies are providing a great facility to engineering field also. In the field of engineering, now people can create different models of different manufacturing products before manufacturing their thing. They can create a model of the thing and that model can be used further for that manufacturing. That's why the manufacturing companies will also try to be more service-oriented in the future. Electronics, computer, and telecommunication. These three things are providing a facility to cut down the time and speed of the transactions of business. Companies which are getting facilities from these value-added services are doing business in a very sharp and fast way nowadays. Now, the successful business will be that business is focusing on having fewer layers of organizational structure, populated by more autonomous units, oriented towards differentiation, producing high value services and goods, creating niche market. For a successful business concern, one have to focus on having fewer layers of organizational structure, populated by more autonomous units. Organization must be oriented towards the differentiation, means value-added product or services, and creating a niche market. High service conciseness and more responsive to customers' need. The organization must be fast in innovations, and it must focus on the use of highly trained and flexible people which are part of their organization. Service industry's characteristics. Now we will discuss about some characteristics of service industry. Service industry is about direct sale, means reaching their clients directly from their main office. These service-oriented organizations have direct access to their clients. The benefits to the clients are provided on their demand, means what they are demanding, the services are all according to those demands. These demands must be completed in the given time. The primary benefit of any service-oriented organization is not a physical product. It is a service which is provided by that organization. There must be a customer participation during the service which is provided by those customers, because this will reduce the errors and also will increase the efficiency of their service. Now, in service sector, time is a very important element. The service must be provided on the given time to the customer. It contains accessing time, queuing time, and action time. Finally, the last characteristic of service industry is customer satisfaction. Customer satisfaction means providing the service which was told by the customer, and after providing their service, taking feedback from their customer. Is the customer satisfied with that service or not? This is the base of any This is the base of success of any organization which is service oriented especially. Now we will move to our next topic, which is the internet commercialization. In the beginning, government was focusing not to commercialize the internet, because in the beginning the internet only was used by the military and the forces around the world. With the time, government has realized the need of the internet. Then they used internet to distribute the information in different sectors of the states. In the beginning, government announced AUP, Acceptable Usage Policy. According to this policy, in the beginning only the non-professional academics or non-professional organizations were able to use the internet for their distribution of information. After some time, these restrictions were also removed. And after the removal of these restrictions, the new era has started. Now let's discuss about the commercialization of ISPs. ISPs stand for Internet Service Providers. In the beginning, government tried to hold the complete control on the internet distribution, and connection given to the users were only from the government sector. But with the time, as the need of internet was increased, the government decided to commercialize the ISPs, means creating the different private internet service providers. Number one is telco, cable or online companies. Number two is national independent ISP. Number three is regional ISP. And number four, the last one, is local ISP. Now we will discuss all these four in detail. Now, the first type of ISP, which is telco, cable or online organization. These are long distance organizations which are providing internet service through telephone lines. As a whole, if we focus on these organizations, these are in different countries and one can dial from one country to other country to access the internet. They are very high in cost. Now let's move to the second type of ISP, which is national independent ISP. It is challenging for the telco, cable, online organizations because they are providing backbone to the small organizations or small ISPs in a country. These organizations support a connectivity of up to 45 MB per second, and this can be used as a backbone for any local ISP. Normally, these ISPs provide support to the organizations, a complete organization. Now let's move to our third type of ISP, which is regional ISP. Regional level ISP can be at the level of national ISP, as per their users or as per the client which are connected to them. But it depends on that ISP. Normally these ISPs are concerned about a state where they are providing internet service. These internet service providers are providing internet at a low cost. If we compare the regional ISP to the national ISP, they are very low in the cost when they are providing internet. Now let's move to the fourth and the last type of the ISP, which is local ISP. Local ISP normally deal in metropolitan area in which they provide a very low cost internet. Normally these ISPs provide dial-up connections by which one can access internet. The internet provided by the local ISP has lower speed than the regional or national ISP. Normally, individuals prefer local ISP because there are less restrictions on local ISP. Let's talk about some other types of ISPs. Number one is bulletin board niche market. Normally, these ISPs are used for small groups. These ISPs provide a grassroots to different small groups. This is basically used for small groups to have access or to communicate with each other. Bulletin board ISP has bad reputation because mostly this type of ISPs are used in pornography. Now, after bulletin board of niche services, let's discuss another type of ISPs, which is freenets, governments and libraries as ISPs. Now, there are different public spots where internet is freely available for the people. These are called municipal computers, which can be used to get information about hospitals and different offices. The access of this computer is for everyone. Now let's talk about the libraries. There are different libraries which are now online. which a person can use to get the information. On the other hand, government is also trying to distribute the information which they have regarding the population of the country or any other data. After discussing the different types of internet service providers, now let's discuss the connectivity options. Connectivity options means the option which a individual or an organization have to connect on internet. These options are based on the bandwidth or the time of the usage. Number one is individual and light usage option. This option is basically for an individual or a group of individuals where they do not want a high volume or high bandwidth. This is very low in cost and one can easily get this package. Let's move to the second option. The second connectivity option is mid-range connectivity option. This option can be for the users more than 10 in an organization where they need a little bit more speed and also their timing may be increased. So they can use mid-range option of connectivity. After that, when we are talking about the organization, when it comes the heavy volume usage option, it means the organization have many computers in their offices and they want a heavy volume of internet and also more time than previous ones. Now let's move to our next topic, which is logistics of being an internet service provider. Logistics means the planning of the processes, means what we are going to plan to be an ISP, internet service provider. This logistics is based on 5 steps. Number 1 is selecting a regional ISP, as a backbone. Number 2 is setting up infrastructure within the organization to connect clients. The third step is setting up dial-up connection and installing softwares. This is a complete process of setting up ISP. After that, one person which is connected to your ISP also need a technical support. Then you have to set up a technical support. And after that, the final step will be targeting and retaining the customers. Means targeting the new customers which are coming to join our ISP and also retaining the old customers by providing them a good facility, a good service or a good support from us. Now let's discuss about the first step, means selecting a backbone, selecting a regional ISP. It is based on the bandwidth which they are providing, the external links in the ISP, the cost of the connection, customer service they provided, and finally comparison of the cost and price and cost and benefit analysis, which will be used to check whether this ISP is good for us as per cost or not. Now it comes about the second step. Second step is creating infrastructure, means setting up a local technology infrastructure. It is based on the following steps, means selecting a router, selecting host protocols, terminal ports, terminal stations, terminal connections, and setting up a modem. Now after that, it comes about the setting up of dial-up connections and software. It means setting up Gopher server for the files which a client can put on our server and can retrieve that. Also the setting up FTP service, also setting up the World Wide Web services and mailing list service. The fourth and the second last step is to provide technical support. It can be provided by making documentation of the help which is needed, like as frequently asked question and etc. It is also provided by telephone. A person can call to the organization's help desk to get some information about a problem which is occurring to him. After that, a company can conduct different training and support programs for different big organizations which are their clients. A company can provide training and workshops for the improvement of the clients. Means if your clients are capable to handle small problems, you can remove your big headache. After that, a company can focus on ongoing communication with the customers because they will give them the feedback about their service, and after getting feedback from the customers, a company can improve their efficiency. And now let's discuss about the fifth and the last step of logistics of being an ISP. The last and the fifth option is targeting and keeping customers. Targeting and keeping customers means getting the feedback from the customers which are already using our services and tackling the different problems which are in our ISP. When these problems are tackled, they will automatically attract the new customers towards their company because these problems are told from the customers and the customer are the best advertisers in the market. When a customer is happy, it means it can increase your customer with the number of one. But if a customer is not agree with the organization, he can decrease your customers with the number of 100. Let's now talk about value added networks. VAN. VAN are basically involved by third party. VAN means involving a third party which can provide you different services. A company can grow its business by getting some other services from a company which is based in those services. These services can be used to increase the efficiency of the organization. There are different benefits of value-added networks, such as direct communication between any trading company, means a company which is using any other platform and our company is using an other platform, they can easily communicate with each other. The vendors of VAN have already knowledge of existing EDI, means they have expertise in their field. They can support multiple data format standards. Also, they will provide a value-added customer support and feedbacks because they already have many other customers which are also telling them about the issues which are occurring in VAN. They can provide a WAN mailbox which is used to receive and forward the messages. They also support 7-11. 7-11 means support of messaging 24 hours if it is required. After that, an organization is very concerned about the auditing. VAN also provide an auditing support to an organization. VAN also support dial-out. When an organization need a dial-out service, a VAN company or vendor can also provide them their service. Now let's talk about the interconnectivity of value-added networks. Means difference between VAN and point-to-point connection. The differentiation can be on following points. Number one, auditing in the VAN is much easier because in PTP, point-to-point connection, the people cannot track a connectivity or the log file easily. VAN can provide connectivity between different platforms, whereas PTP is only used on the same platform. The cost of the PTP is more than the cost of VAN. And also, the security provided by the VAN vendors is more secure than a company which is creating its own security without any expertise. Now, let's talk about the selecting TPSP. TPSP stands for Third Party Service Providers. When you are selecting a third party service provider, you must keep in mind that the service provider must be generic. The service provider which one is selecting, it must be according to the business which we are already doing. And also one has to focus on that service provider which has large number of clients, because when a company or when a vendor has large number of clients in VAN, it means you have also option to a large number of clients. Now let's talk about the internal control of VAN, means value added networks. The internal control of VAN is good because a VAN does not allow an external user to direct connect to a VAN. That's why the data of the organization is always secure. There is also a disadvantage in VAN, which is when a message is sent, the message is saved at a server of VAN and one can easily access that message. And all the messages which are coming from different companies are saved in a single machine which can be hacked by a hacker. Internal control also focus on the audit facilities. One must check a vendor whether they are providing audit control or not and their audit control is good or not. Because a company always need a audit, and when a vendor of VAN is providing you audit, it means you can easily audit your organization's transactions. When we are talking about the internal control of VAN, one must focus on access control, the people who are accessing the VAN. means only the authorized people can access that VAN. Data integrity means only the authorized persons can change or delete the data from their VAN. Third one is message authentication code. After that, it comes about the encryption. The encryption algorithm or method must be secure and good one, which can secure the data of organization on a VAN. After that, it comes about the transmission security. The security on the routers and security on the service must be high, because the value of the transactions or the data or the information of a company is very high. After that, it comes about the message authorization, message authentication, message delivery, and the last one is message protections. It means all the process, all the transaction, or all the process of sending message from here to there must be secure, and it must be protected from any other access or any unauthorized access. Now let's talk about the liabilities of third party networks. Liability of third party network provider is same like as post office or postal office of a government. But it is meaningless when the message is a payment order, because in post office you are not sending a payment message from here to there, which is very costly. The agreement of the liabilities are different according to the different countries, because the countries have different terms and conditions and taxes rules. That's why the liability for the different countries is always selected according to the law and regulation of their country. When we are talking about the liabilities, two major questions are arises always, and one must focus on these two questions. Number one is, does the message contributes to or establish a contract between the trading partners? The second question is, do any government regulation which can place restrictions on use? So the liabilities is always according to the country in which you are dealing. Finally, we are going to discuss the conclusion of our presentation. To support the e-commerce, a new industry has emerged, which is called ISPs. ISPs are providing different value-added services to e-commerce, which are now used to fasten the transactions and also fastly capture the different markets. These values are based on the requirement of the business, and these value-added services are facilitating the businesses to grow quickly. Internet service providers are not providing contents. They are just providing a door towards contents which are available on internet. Means available from different sources on the internet. They are just giving you a route, a way to reach those contents. Commercialization and privatization of internet is providing a great extent to e-commerce, because after privatization and commercializations, people are now more focusing on creating new value-added services day by day. These value-added services will drive the internet growth to a very large extent. In future, these value-added services will provide a complete automated transactions. This was my presentation about value-added services. Hope you enjoyed it. If you have any question or query, you can send me email at gmuhiyudin, that is gmuhiyudin@gmail.com. I will look forward for your questions. Hopefully, I will answer you within 24 hours. Allah Hafiz.